morning, EBC family. Glad you could be here with us again. Lift your voices up with us as we sing of our hope that is present and yet to come.
There's a future in hope. I see you moving in close. There's a light leading home, and it's where we wanna go. There's a future in hope. I see you moving in close. There's a light leading home, and it's where we wanna go. It's where we wanna go. Better than we ever imagined. You are the God everlasting. See the impossible happen. All the best is yet to come. Sorrow may last for a moment. Joy will be here in the morning. You are the God of the broken. All the best is yet to come. There's a day drawing near when the chaos will clear. Every tear disappear. Who's where? We wanna go better than we ever imagined. You're the God everlasting. See the impossible happen. All the best is yet to come. Sorrow may last for a moment. Joy will be here in the morning. You're the God of the broken. All the best is yet to come. One day you will right all wrongs. Every nation, tribe and tongue will join as one. Sing your song, the best is yet to come. One day you will right all wrongs. Every nation, tribe and tongue will join as one. Sing your song, the best is yet to come. Better than we ever imagined. You the God everlasting. See the impossible happen. All the best is yet to come. Sorrow may last for a moment. Joy will be in the morning. You the God of the broken. All the best is yet to come. All the best is yet to come. All the best is yet to
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Those words flow from the pen of an allegorical man overwhelmed with bitterness and grief. They're recorded for us in the book of Lamentations. And Lamentations was written during a dark time in the history of Israel. It was written when Jerusalem had been destroyed and the Israelites were dragged off into exile in Babylon. And in the midst of this great upheaval, this man, he writes, mercies are new every morning. And he goes on and he exhorts Israel to turn away from sin and seek God's mercy. Finally, he says, the Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him.
Mercy, morning by morning, never stops rising. It's new every day. Mercy.
sunrise, bright as a daylight after the rain. I walk through the valley of the shadow. Darkest night, more than I broke through my fears and pride, only to find you there all the time. Oh, mercy. Morning by morning, never stops rising, it's new every day. Mercy, sweet as the sunrise, bright as a day. The rain. Walked in light and found my freedom. Known the joys of a balmy life. All the time. Oh, mercy. Morning by morning, never stops rising, it's new every day. Mercy, sweet as the sunrise, bright as a daylight after the rain. Control tomorrow, but I can trust you here today, and I will follow till the promised day when everything fades. But mercy. Morning by morning, never stops rising, it's new every day. Mercy, sweet as the sunrise, bright as the day. Bright as a daylight. the Second Samuel 12, 1 through 10. The Lord sent Nathan to David. When he came to him, he said, "There were two men in a certain town, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a very large number of sheep and cattle, but the poor man had nothing but one little lamb he had bought. He raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare a meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the lamb that belonged to the poor man and prepared it for the one who had come to him. David burned in anger against the man and said to Nathan, 'As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this must die. He must pay for the lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity.' Then Nathan said to David, 'You are the man. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I anointed you king over Israel and delivered you from the hands of Saul. I gave your master's house to you and your master's wives into your arms. I gave you all Israel and Judah. And if all this had been too little, I would have given you even more. Why did you despise the word of the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with a sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with the sword of the Amorites. Now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your own."
God, we thank you for the opportunity we have to look at your word, and we pray, God, that you would guide us into all truth. We thank you for the Spirit of God that teaches us. We thank you for the Spirit of God that convicts us. We thank you for the Spirit of God who comforts, encourages us, motivates us, urges us, enables us to live our lives for you. So guide us in our passage this morning. Teach us your ways, I pray, in your name. Amen. Conscience is the small, clear voice deep down inside of you where the acoustics are very bad. I'm not sure who said it, but it stuck with me. Conscience is a small, clear voice deep in, down inside of you where the acoustics are very bad. Where do you go with a guilty conscience? Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the creator of the master detective Sherlock Holmes, was quite the prankster. The story is told of one time when he played a practical joke on five of the most prominent men in England. He sent an anonymous note to all five of these prominent men that said, "All is found out, flee at once." And within 24 hours, all five men left the country. Doyle knew nothing of any secrets these men had, but he played on the assumption that everyone has secrets. Where can we go with our guilt? How do we guilt well? Well, look with me in your Bibles to 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12. Our current sermon series has been tracing the greatest story from cover to cover. And from the promise to Abraham that through his seed would come a great nation that would bring a blessing to all people, much progress has been made to where we are in that storyline of a great nation becoming a reality under the kingship of David. But David was far from a perfect king. We left off last time with a man after God's own heart falling hard. David was, as you remember, he was web surfing on his palace roof, and he saw a bathing beauty. And in order to act on what he saw, there had to be a forgetfulness of God. No one can carry on in sin while thinking of God. They can't coexist. So David saw, he sent, he took, and he slept with another man's wife. David could only hope that in his moment of lust, nothing bad would come of it, but something did. Bathsheba became pregnant. Life got really complicated for David. You see, sin always complicates things. And rather than ending his relationship to that sin right there and confessing up, he covered up. And after two failed attempts, carefully crafted by David to get Bathsheba's husband Uriah to sleep with his wife to make it look like the baby was theirs, David went on to plan C. In desperate maneuver, David ordered Uriah's murder through a designed path that looked like it was going to be a battlefield tragedy. And so now, with a husband gone, David would take Bathsheba as his wife with the hopes that no one would do the math and that the child born came to them as a happy married couple. What a mess. What a mess. In a moment like this, if you didn't know the rest of the story, you might wonder, is there a way back for David? Is this the end of his story? Is God through with David? Well, that brings us to 2 Samuel 12. And since there are no chapter breaks in the original scriptures, look with me at the last sentence of the last verse of 2 Samuel 11. The end of verse 27 of chapter 11 informs us of what God thought about what David did. And it says there at the end of verse 27, the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. Now, I don't know about you, but that to me seems like a gross understatement. This sin grieved the Lord. Yet David continues to ignore the bad acoustics playing inside of him. David just wants to just move on from it. After all, there's a country to run. There's national security matters to attend to, a new family that needed him. But here's David's royal miscalculation. God refuses to do that. God won't just move on. And so as we come to 2 Samuel chapter 12, God enters the story. Now, in my Bible, the heading is Nathan Rebukes David. But really, this scene could be summed up in one word, grace. Grace. All right, I want to give you three words to hang this passage and the one we're going to look at in Psalm. I want to hang all this, what these words onto, just three words, confrontation, consequences, and confession. Confrontation, consequences, and confession, and then we'll look at the continuing story. All right, let's look at confrontation. We pick it up here in verse 1, but remember that last line now, the thing David had done displeased the Lord. Now God's about to act. Verse 1, chapter 12, the Lord sent Nathan to David. Now church, those are words of grace. Grace. After a period of several months, anywhere from 9 months to a year, David is then confronted. Have you ever been confronted on a wrong? Well, see that as an opportunity of God opening the door of grace to you. Well, God sends Nathan to confront David, and how does he do that? Well, Nathan barrels through the door. I mean, he can't wait to point out to David his sin, and he gets in David's face, and he says, David, there's sin in your life. David, you really blew it this time. No, that isn't Nathan's approach at all. He kind of comes at it from the back door. Nathan, the prophet, sent by God, then tells David a little story. You can read it for yourself there in verses 1 through 4. And it went something like this. A rich man had some house guests, and he needed some lamb chops. And rather than take a lamb from his own abundant flocks, he took this sweet little lamb from his very poor neighbor. This poor man took care of the lamb that he had like we would take care of a little puppy. He was a lap lamb, we might say. He was sitting on his lap. He was drinking out of the poor man's bowl. And this rich man comes along, takes the only little lamb that he had. And you kind of go, well, what kind of person would take someone else's pet lamb, butcher it, and cook it? I mean, how heartless is that? What kind of person who was blessed with so much take from someone who had so little? Who does that? I mean, doesn't it anger you when someone is greedy? Doesn't it anger you when someone is greedy and they hoard the stuff that you kind of wanted to stack up for yourself? Doesn't it irritate you when someone is so selfish and they push in front of you at that line that you maneuvered so well to get that spot ahead of them? See, when it comes to others in their sin, we have 20/20 vision, don't we? Have you noticed how the characteristics in someone else that irritates us the most is often the very thing that we haven't dealt with in our own life? I mean, if you ever felt that way, then you can probably appreciate David's reaction to this little story that Nathan told. Nathan has David hooked. And verse 5 tells us when David heard this story, he was ticked. Actually, it says David burned with anger against the man. Well, David even goes on as far as to say the man who did this deserves to die. And then he goes, he must pay for that land four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity. Well, as David is then spewing off all that should happen to this wealthy man who took advantage of his power, Nathan says, you are the man. Not you are the man, not in a good way, but you are the man, the wealthy man, the man with power, the man who had everything, taking something precious from someone else. David, you are that man. The man in this story, David, that made you angry, that is you. Nathan pulls no punches. You know, we all need a Nathan in our life. And he says to David in verse 9, why have you despised the word of the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah and took his wife to be your own. And then Nathan lays out the consequences in verse 10. The consequences. We pick it up in verse 10. Now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite as your own. Out of your own household, I am going to bring calamity upon you. Before your very eyes, I will take your wives and give them to one who is close to you, and he will lie with your wives in broad daylight. You did it in secret, but I will do this thing in broad daylight before all Israel. And then verse 14 goes on to tell us that David's sin leads to the death of his child. You see the consequences? Not only that, but there was total turmoil of David's family, including the rape of Tamar, one of David's daughters, by one of David's sons. David's son Absalom, later on, he sleeps with David's wives on the roof for everyone to see. There's the deaths of Ammon and Absalom, and then there's carrying on of some family dysfunction. I mean, David's sin impacted many lives. See, we don't sin in isolation, nor do we sin without consequences. We may try and manage and confine the consequences, but we just can't. Sin always has consequences we don't count on. As much as we wish we could unwind some of what has happened in the past, it can't be done. Stories told of a police officer who stopped a teenage girl in Idaho after complaints that a car had been seen going around her neighborhood in reverse for some time. And it was going round and round in reverse in this neighborhood. And so the police came up to the girl and asked, what in the world is going on? And she said, well, you see, my parents let me use this car, but I had too much mileage on it. I was just trying to unwind some of it, she said. Now, do you suppose if David could have had the ability to rewind the tape, to rewind some of the mileage, he would have jumped at the chance? Do you suppose if years later you were to interview David and ask, was it worth it? That one night stand with Bathsheba, was it worth it? Well, Nathan confronts David. He lays out the consequences. Well, would that be the end of it right there? Would David be broken or would he be hardened? Would David know what to do after he sinned? Would he get right after he had done wrong? Well, if you look down to verse 13, we see David's response. Follow along here. David's response in verse 13. David says, "Nathan, it's not my fault. What in the world was Bathsheba doing in such a bathing in such a visible location in the first place? I mean, if she only dressed more appropriately, this wouldn't have happened. And you know, things haven't been so great at home with my wife. You know, if she..." David doesn't say any of that, does he? He doesn't say, "You know, Nathan, how stressful it is being a king. Do you know how hard it is, Nathan, to live up to be a man after God's own heart?" He doesn't say, "I just couldn't help myself." David didn't blame it on his diet or long hours at work or Uncle Billy's influence when he was a kid. No, none of that. The confrontation leads to a confession. A confrontation doesn't always work out that way, but for David it did. And so we look at the confession, what David really says here in verse 13. He says, "I have sinned. And not only I have sinned, but I have sinned against the Lord." David realizes his sin and ultimately who the sin is against. And then we have these reassuring words, "The Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to die." Now, if David got what he deserved, he could have died for this sin. But God chose to forgive him. David is a forgiven man. Now, we have recorded for us in Scripture David's words of lament over his sin. And you find that in Psalm 51. And so, look with me in your Bibles to Psalm 51. Psalm 51 is the cry of a broken man. Now, we're not going to have time to dig into this psalm in great detail, but I do want to camp here just for a few minutes, for we have a beautiful picture of what true confession looks like and that God's grace and forgiveness is greater than our sin. Well, follow along as I read verses 1 through 4 to see David's perspective on sin. Psalm 51, verse 1, he says, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge." Now notice here, David uses three words to describe his sin. You can do some word study on these three words if you want. It would be a helpful exercise. But the three words are transgressions, iniquity, and sin. They're synonyms. Yet the force of these three words placed together is meant to show the seriousness of sin and how David viewed his sin. David recognizes that his sin is ultimately against God. He says that in verse 4. Against you, you only have I sinned. Now, that's not to say that we have no need to ask for forgiveness from others, for we do. That's not to say we should underestimate the power of sin to bring pain on others, for it does. But ultimately, we have defied the infinitely holy God of the universe. Our offense is to God first and foremost. And then the end of verse 4, David says, "So you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge." Now, what David is saying here is, "I agree with you, Lord, as to what you say about sin." That's true confession, by the way, because confess means to agree with God. Literally, confess means to say the same, to say the same. So confess then, when we confess our sins, we are saying the same thing about our sin that God says about it. It's to agree with God in what he calls it. And in a culture that has given nice and less offensive names to our sin, we can easily minimize the seriousness of our sin. Oh, how we cover up our sins by giving them polite names. See, God doesn't call it a concern. He calls it gossip. He doesn't call it an affair. He calls it adultery or fornication. He doesn't call it a male thing. He calls it lust. He doesn't call it fudging a bit on my taxes. He calls it deception. He doesn't call it good business. He calls it dishonesty. He doesn't call it stretching the truth. He calls it lying. He doesn't call it being out of sorts. He calls it anger. He doesn't call it venting my frustration. He calls it grumbling and complaining. He doesn't call it a mistake. He calls it sin. What do you need to call it? What do you need to call it? A woman came to her pastor and said, "You know, I'm troubled about a problem I know is hurting my testimony. I tend to exaggerate. I seem to enlarge a story until it's all distorted, and so people don't trust me." Well, the pastor replied, "Well, let's confess that to the Lord." So she began to pray, "Oh God, you know I have a tendency to exaggerate." Well, the pastor immediately interrupted her and said, "No, call it lying, ma'am, and you may get over it. Call it lying." And the woman began to weep because she knew he was right. She had been trying to make lying acceptable. You've heard me probably say this before, but if you can't name it, you can't change it. What do you need to call it? And if you're still making excuses for it, then you don't really see it for what it is. As it's been said, the blood of Jesus never cleansed an excuse. So right view of our sin leads to true confession. We see that clearly here in Psalm 51. David felt the weight of his sin. All right, now what? Where can we go with our guilt? How do we guilt well? How do we guilt well? Well, we can't remove the guilt through therapy alone. We can't remove the guilt by well-intentioned resolutions or trying just to replace it with happy thoughts. Guilt doesn't go away by clearing your history on your computer. Guilt doesn't go away by hitting the delete button or by simply saying, "I don't want to think about it anymore." It doesn't even go away by going to church and singing your heart out on Sunday morning. The only place we can go with our guilt and brokenness is before God. The only cure for our guilt is God. See, our view of sin is that it's serious, but our view of God is that He is gracious, merciful, and He wants something to happen deep within. And so, confession then is the connection between our view of sin and our view of God. It is only as we honestly acknowledge our sin and plead for His forgiveness that we can find a cure for our guilt. And so we need to guilt well. We need to guilt well. And to guilt well is more than just feeling bad. It's more than even being angry with ourselves. It's more than even feeling sorry. To guilt well is to acknowledge our sin before holy God by agreeing with Him that He is right in what He calls it, and by turning away from that sin and then living as a forgiven person. We need to allow that guilt we are experiencing lead us to a positive outcome. And so David says here in verse 7 of Psalm 51, "Cleanse me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me and I'll be whiter than snow." Well, what in the world is hyssop? Well, hyssop is spoken of in the book of Leviticus and Numbers, and it refers to a small plant which, because of the way it was shaped, could be used like a small paintbrush. And the priest would take the hyssop, and he would dip it in some of the blood of the animal, and then he'd sprinkle or brush that blood over a sacrifice or an offering. In another instance, the Israelites took hyssop, they dipped it in the blood in the basin, and then brushed it on their doorposts. Cleanse me with hyssop. That's David's way of saying he expects his sin to be removed from him, and the penalty for his sin has been paid for by something or someone else beside him. In other words, David knows that only God can make him clean. God stands in as priest and cleanses him from his sin and the penalty of sin, that only God, who is greater than our guilt, can do something about our guilt. There's only one thing that can be done with guilt, and that's to have it washed away. And there's only one who can wash it away. Well, David eventually came around. Eventually, David knew how to get right after he'd done wrong. And I ask you, do you guilt well? Do you know where to go with your guilt? All right, let's look at the continuing story. The continuing story. A man, after God's own heart, falls into sin. He's far from a perfect king, David's imperfections as king left people longing for another king who would rule perfectly. And from 2 Samuel onward, we're waiting for the arrival of God's perfect king, the son of David, the Lord Jesus. The king who would be the one to restore the world to what God intended for it to be. The king, the prophets and writers of scripture continually look forward, who would come from the line of David. The continuing story points to the perfect king to come. It shows us that even this great king David needed a greater king, Jesus Christ, the son of David. Only Jesus Christ can lead us in all our imperfections to the glorious kingdom where God dwells and where we can live lives that honor him perfectly. Now, the Gospel of Matthew lays out the genealogy, and that from this line of David and Bathsheba is born the Lord Jesus Christ. Now that, to me, is absolutely amazing. That God can use our mess ups and for his purpose. That God is a God of grace and new beginnings. That he still works through imperfect, broken people. See, the story within the story is all about God's grace. And in the midst of an ugly story about sin and a major blowout, we find the gospel here. It's to come to Jesus with our ugliness, our terrible choices, our twisted deception, and all the mess inside, and discover God's invitation to come clean. All that David did, as bad as it was, is outdone by God's grace. All that you have done is outdone by God's grace. And you go, well, but Pastor, you don't know what I've done. You don't know the skeletons in my closet. You don't know the dark side of my life. Well, there's no sin so big and ugly that God's grace doesn't loom larger. God takes our sins, Corrie ten Boom said. God takes our sins, the past, the present, and the future, and he dumps them all in the sea, and he puts up a sign that says, no fishing allowed. Pastor Gene stepped down from ministry to address a particular sin in his life that held him in chains. And he was so filled with guilt and shame that he told himself that he would never get free. Well, he speaks of a vivid dream that he had one night. And in this dream, he saw himself sitting in a courtroom. The prosecutor stood to present the case and began by pulling down a screen showing a video of Gene's life and every sordid detail. The prosecutor concluded the case by saying, this man has fallen into sin. And Gene, in his dream, he said he could only bow his head in total shame. Well, in his dream, he says, then the defense attorney stood to present Gene's case, and he declared, everything the prosecution has shown you is true. Every detail is correct, all except one. He left out one key ingredient. Everything Gene did was paid for. And Gene's attorney pulled off his shirt. He showed the scars on his back and asked that they be entered as evidence. He showed his hands, his feet, and his side, and he proclaimed, I don't deny that Gene has done what he has done, but it already has been paid for. Gene said that when he woke up from that dream, he felt free. He grasped for the first time how he could have done all the things he had done and still be washed, cleansed, and forgiven. Yet there were consequences for his actions, but he understood the cross, the new beginning offered to him. As the hymn writer so aptly put it, Jesus paid it all. Christ died in your place so a soul so unworthy and wretched can live. Mark this down. When God says he forgives, he forgives. You are declared not guilty. Will you believe what he has said is true of you? Do you figure that your sin is so great that you can't be forgiven? Well, remember, God is greater than our guilt. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for that wonderful truth God, help us to live as forgiven people. You don't want us to live in self-condemnation. You don't want us to keep beating ourselves up over past sin or present sin. But you want us to live in that place where we understand the sufficiency of your death on the cross, and that it covered, it took away, it paid for not some, not most, but all of our sin. And we thank you for that. Help us to live with a gospel in mind, live with the gospel central to our hearts and lives as we live each day for you. And may we then share that gospel with those around us, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
There is love that came for us, humbled to a sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness. You rose again victorious. Faithfulness none can deny. Through the storm and through the fire, there is truth that sets me free, Jesus Christ, who lives in me. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of all. Save the lost, you paid it all upon the cross. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord.
Church, go in the confidence that His grace is greater than your sin. May that assurance motivate you to know Him better and to live lives pleasing to Him while you wait for the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen.